All right, it's good to be back on our service tonight, Wednesday night. We want to be much in prayer, a lot to be praying about. I think we ought to be praying before the storm gets here. What do y'all think? Praying for the safety of all involved before the storm is to come. And let's just pray God will watch over everybody, keep everybody in his arms and secure. Then there's lots of sickness to pray about. Just Wayne just got a text on his phone, Eddie Broom. Has had a stroke and he's in real bad condition. I'd like for y'all to remember Eddie and pray for him. Keep praying for Joe. They're supposed to do a test on him Friday, and pray for him. And Kathy's brother didn't get the real good results that they wanted today, so he's getting a second opinion on his lung, and so be much in prayer about that. Keep praying where death has come, all the families that's lost their loved ones, Janice's family and Sandra's family, others that's lost loved ones, and keep praying for all the sick and afflicted. That's why my father needs prayer. He's not been doing real good about being able to get around. Most all, he needs to get saved. I can pray for that. Pray for all the family. Pray the Lord to touch and help us. Pray for our nation. Pray for Israel. Pray for all the things that's going on. Anybody else got a request before we pray?
Keep praying for my family.
Amen.
My family.
Amen.
And also, this fellow at work, he asked for prayer. He said he had a lot of family issues. And his name's Alan Murphy, and he asked for prayer.
Amen.
And for those that I have to rest on, because they're really going, they're going to be upset for one if we ain't get to come tomorrow, but just remember. All this is a stress when they're hearing on TV and stuff, when they don't know what's coming or whatever, you know.
Amen.
Wait for me, David. I felt them last night. And this coffee table broke.
Oh, well, that better to broke the table than to broke you, right?
Yeah.
Amen. Yours won't lock, did it? Okay.
Mary Ann Stennis, she called. She said she still had a problem with her ankle. She wants to get back in church.
Amen. Would you like to see her in church?
I don't know the lady's name, but it's the mother of a lady I worked for this morning. She's in a rest home. She's been having pain for 6 weeks, and they, at the rest home. So she finally got her before she could get her into the doctor, and she's got a broken hip or back joint. Well, I think she has her hip that was broke, fractured. And then last night, she fell out of bed again.
Let's pray for her. As a guy that he's friends with Jennifer, the lady that helps us, and his sugar was over 600, and he finally went to the emergency room, and I forget what his blood pressure was, way out of sight. And so I pray that the Lord would help get that sugar and everything under control. And like I said, we don't have to know his name, just need to know that there's a need out there, right?
Amen.
And Marilyn, she's had pneumonia.
I got to talk with her, and she's feeling better. Maybe she's going to get to come Sunday if she can keep doing well. So remember her, she was in the hospital one night. I told her I was going to come down there and wring their necks for not letting nobody know what was going on. But do pray for Marilyn and pray for the family.
A little boy named Jeremiah, he just got out of brain surgery today, brain cancer, second time. So he's
good. Jeremiah, yes. Yeah, and he's going to be in St. Jude's for a little while. Yeah. So let's be much in prayer about that. Amen. We're looking forward to get to see that baby. That's usually a common thing. And let's keep praying for them. We got, like I said, we got to see the other little baby too, that baby Iris, that was born premature. She's doing really good. And we've got Charles, we got Jenna Rose, and there's four prayers that's been answered right there with children. So ain't you glad? Ain't you glad God's still on the scene? All right, anyone else?
Where's Sandra Gentry too?
Sandra, amen. They, Pray for that whole family. I got to talk with Sandra this week, so pray for that family over there. And like I said, Janice's family, all of the family there. Anyone else?
You mentioned Florida. My niece Lacey lives right in Fort Myers, and I think that's right on the path, unless it's changed direction. So just remember her and her family.
Yeah, they kind of were just saying there's going to be a 9-foot surge or something like that. There's breaking down there. So
you'll get cold when you hit land.
Aaron said that the governor down there did a mandatory evacuation.
Oh, okay, in Florida.
Good.
Anyone else?
Mary Davis put on here for her family, and then my sister-in-law Shannon sprained or fractured her arm with a patient the other day, and then she has some tests that came back not in the range of the levels that the doctors like, and so they were sending her for more tests and follow up to see what's going on. So,
amen.
I had a patient that was out of his mind that attacked her.
He needs prayer too.
Right. Amen. Yeah. Amen. Miss Davis is going to have knee surgery, and her husband is under hospice care too there, and she's got him at home. So she really needs our prayer. She's faithful to us and faithful to this broadcast. We've never met her, but we feel like we've known her all of our life. And so we appreciate her and all of her family. All right? Unspoken, lift your hand. Well, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Wayne's been having, himself been hurting, but let's remember him also today and pray for him. All right. Wayne, ask God's blessing, please.
Dear Heavenly Father, we come to you this song, so we know how to sing.
Yes, Lord.
Thank you for this church and Brother David.
God, help us tonight, Father, to lift your name up. Father, I pray for all the requests, God, tonight.
Request on and on.
Thank you, Jesus.
Let your will be done. Remember the nation. We just ask this in a wonderful, sweet name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. But I'm going to try 172. Oh. We'll just stop and start all over again. Amen. There is something in my soul which keeps the shadows all the way. It is love, my Savior's love. All the light and every burden gives me gladness day by day. It is love, my Savior's love. Oh, the praise. Something keeps me feeling strong. It is love, I say love. Something makes my life a blessing to me. It is strong. It is love, I say love. Oh, the precious love of Jesus. At your heels, my ransom soul. Oh, and more, I'll say it praise by the high. And bowed in sorrow, something waits for you today. It is love, my Savior's love. It would give you peace and comfort, make your burden roll away. It is love, my Savior's love. Oh, the precious love of Jesus. I thrill my rapid soul. More and more I'll sing and praise while the night. It is love, my Savior's love. Are you glad you're saved?
Amen.
Let's turn over to the back of the book at 409. We'll do a couple, two or three verses of this song if we can, Father Alone. I'm gonna have to hunt a key, maybe try E flat, start out with. Tempted and tried with all made to wonder why it should be
practicing.
Oh, she has.
Me and Faye heard
it. Y'all heard her practice.
Well,
all right, Donna, come on.
That's okay. Right, I've got the mirror in my mouth. You don't want in there.
What an excuse.
Is that the most excuse you've ever heard?
From the looks of that jaw, it must have been a whole pack. All right, buddy, come on. Anyway, I just got aggravated a little bit. Bless you, son.
What song do you sing in Wayne?
Okay.
We gotta keep a good eye on Donna because she knows the song you sing. She done told us. Oh, she knows.
Oh, so
she,
yes.
Oh, okay.
Donna, which one you want to do?
Yeah, which one you want to do, Donna? He'll let you help.
Oh.
He'll let you speak candy out and ask him.
Oh.
Oh.
Oh, I've got lockjaw.
I don't believe that. I don't either, because there ain't been no shouts coming from over there in that area. What she going to do is spend all night around the hole in that lifesaver. Donna, I think you sang the one you knew last week.
I don't got that song lockjaw in my book.
Yeah, remember he sung because he lives, and you said you sat there and sung
that. I'll sing it with you. Are you going to sing that one tonight?
Yeah.
I'm going to sing it.
I'm going to get up here and do it.
Please don't make me do it. I'm shy.
Wait a minute, come on up here. He's singing that right now. Please don't make me do it. Come on, Donna B. Show me how brave you are. I'm going to kick it off for you right here. See, once you sing yours, that puts Chase on the spot. He's got to get in there.
Okay. I'm not sure I'm going to miss this minute.
She's still on that hole in that lifesaver.
I got a pocket full of you all.
That was good. I'm glad you got up. That was really good. On his back for several months, and I told him, I said, sometimes God's got to knock you off your feet to make you look up. And he said, yeah, I realize that now. And he supposedly had straightened his life out and gave it to the Lord and everything while he was in the hospital, but he got out and he had it. So I hope that one day he realizes just how much he needs him, you know, before time runs out. You know what? Man. Let's see here. I can find the song that I was looking for. I don't know if Jean's watching tonight or not, but she asked for this song the last time she was in church with us, and if I can find it here, and I know it's right in this book somewhere, I want to do it for her, and then if she can go back and play it if she misses it. How's that work? So, of course, I may not find it. There it is. There it is. Is this sticking together? Find them out there. Keep E quiet and see what happens. In Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my life, my strength. This cornerstone, this haunted ground, burn through the fiercest trial and storm. One high to love.
Send us out to all of our family that's listening in and watching, and we appreciate all of you today. Jesus said that he would come again sometime. To take the righteous name of God away. He said that when he comes, he'll give no warning. So be ready, cause the Lord will come today. This could be your last chance to find Jesus. This could your last chance to pray. Tomorrow could be too late for praying. The coming of the Lord could be the day. Every day. The one thing that we know for sure, he's coming. It's closer now than it was yesterday. different view, maybe. To some it's just an emblem, a formality. It's a symbol that's been used so frequently. To be blaspheme and despise us, it says it's still abides. He took the nails for you and me. The angels watched as he died for the Lord. He could have walked away. He chose to grow. You see why this soul will grow. It's so dear. Good for suffering, yet it brought us peace. It bridged the gap for me, cleansing all my sin. And I come to remind us that we're free. There was a cross made for the Son of God. Pieces of rough timber on me. With hands and through his feet, he took the nails for you and me. The angels watched as he died for the Lord. He could have walked away. He chose to. He took the nails for you and me. The angel watched as he died for the Lord. He could have walked away. He chose to grow. He could have walked away. Do remember to keep praying. Pray for the sick, the afflicted. Pray for these that's lost their loved ones. Pray for these in the pathway of the storm. And you know, it shows that we in the pathway of the storm. And let's just pray that the Lord will help us all and keep us all safe, right? All right. We pray for Joseph now as he comes.
Good to be here again this evening. Thank you, William, for turning on the fans. I don't know about y'all, but I'm up. We're going to be in the book of Zechariah, starting off, chapter 3. I can get everything situated here.
Yeah, I know I always like to go to the Lord in prayer first and pray that what the Lord's got for us and the message that we'll get it. And sometimes that's a kick in the rear end, sometimes it's not, sometimes it's just uplifting. But whatever it is that you need, I hope that you get. Maybe be a slap in the face, I don't know. But you need whatever God needs to give you, I pray that you'll get out of it. Let us pray. Lord, we come before you as humble as we know how. So thankful for this opportunity to stand here once again tonight. Lord, we don't claim to be anything, but you are everything. Lord, we ask that you forgive us of our sins and our shortcomings, of our faults and failures, that there'll be no hindrance in the movement of your spirit. You know the needs that are out there. You know the needs that are here. God, we leave them all in your hands. And we ask that you touch each and every heart in the way that they need to be touched, stirred in the way they need to be stirred. Lord, that in all things they'll find what they need in you here tonight. God, we give you the praise, the honor, and glory in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Just two verses there. It says, and he showed me Joshua the high priest standing before the angel of the Lord, and Satan standing at the right hand to resist him. And the Lord said unto Satan, the Lord rebuke thee, O Satan, even the Lord that hath chosen Jerusalem rebuke thee. Is not this a brand plucked out of the fire? Y'all can be seated. This evening I want to talk to you a little bit about endurance. About endurance. So often when pressed, we get to the point where we just want to lay down and give up. Anybody been there? Huh? Come on. You ever get to the point you just want to lay down and say, well, just forget it. Forget it all, dadgummit. Come on. Right? Sometimes it's because we're just weary. We're wore out from the battle. We've been pressed upon until we just don't know what we're going to do anymore. Been there? Emotionally depressed, distressed. Not that you don't have any faith in God, but that you just wore out. You just don't know what's coming around the next turn. It seems like every way that you turn, that things are falling apart. Have you been there? You try your best to hold on to faith. You try your best to keep on believing and keep trusting, but it seems the more that you pray, the less it's getting answered. That's what it seems like. Right? I've been there. I'm not just talking to y'all, I'm talking to myself. I've been there when it didn't seem like I had another hope. Like I had another prayer. It just seemed like that no matter which way I turned, I couldn't get the answer. But the problem is, Donna, is I wasn't getting the answer I was looking for. God was working and he was answering. I just wasn't getting it answered the way that I wanted to be answered. Anybody ever seen that? Amen. But sometimes, like I said, it's just because we're tired, we're discouraged and broken. David wrote in Psalm 6:6, he said, I am weary with the groaning, with my groaning. All the night I make I my bed to swim. I water my couch with my tears. The words, I got a little tongue twisted there. I'm going to try that again. I am weary with my groaning. All the night make I my bed to swim. I water my couch with my tears. You ever been at that point to where all you can do is just sit there and cry? I mean, you didn't know what else to do. You tried everything you knew to do. All you can do is just sit there and cry. That's what he's talking about. He got to a time that he is so broken, so stressed out, so grieved that his bed became like he could swim in it. It was so wet, is what he was saying. He cried so much. Anybody ever cried so much that their bed was wet? That the couch was wet, that the floor was wet. Then he talked about the stains on the altar, about the tear stains on the altar when people's praying. It ain't just when they're praying, though, when you get this point. Sometimes it's just after you pray or before you pray. You're just sitting there so distressed and so upset. Job 10:1 said, Job said, my soul is weary of my life. I will leave my complaint upon myself. I will speak in the bitterness of my soul. If anybody had something to be weary about, it was Job, wasn't it? Everything that happened to him, all the struggles and trials. And he was so down and out that he was weary of his life. Anybody ever been there? I've heard people say, well, it'd just be better to end it all. Are you sure? Are you sure?
No. You know, many times we get to that point of brokenness. Many people do. I want to tell you here, if anybody has ever told you that serving God was going to be a life of joy and happiness all the time, I've told y'all this before, they lied to you. Because the devil's going to come against us to try to tear us down. It's his job. It's his job. You know, other times, than when we're broken and weary and discouraged, other times it's our lack of ambitions that drive us to quit, to want to give up, to just lay down. Our lack of, for a better word, we become lazy. Kind of like all the couch potatoes we hear about, just want to sit on there and want everybody to give something to them. They become lazy, don't want to lift up a hand to do nothing. She's patting Chase. I thought Chase worked. No, I can't. But anyway, you know, people get lazy and complacent. You know, everybody is quick to testify that they've been weary and discouraged, that they've been battered, but not very many people are quick to say, yeah, I've been lazy and I've just not done what I should have done. But there's a lot of people that's been, even in those that have been beaten and battered and torn. Sometimes laziness comes in as we get wore out, doesn't it? You know, Galatians 6:9 said, let us not be weary in well-doing, for in due season we shall reap if we faint not. Right? But what are you going to reap, though, if you are failing to sow? If you're laying down and putting the seed to the side, or if you refuse to do that which God is telling you to do, or maybe you're sowing, but you're lacking determination and lack of joy or lack of feeling in the seed that you are sowing. You know, it talks about he that reaps in tears. That's somebody who cares about what they're doing, somebody who is going forth with a desire. What if your lack of determination is bleeding over in the seeds that you sow? Your lack for the love for God and dedication to Him is going over. So you're not sowing seeds that you should sow. You're sowing seeds that have been tainted by your sins and your lusts. If you go back up to verses in Galatians there, 6:7-8, it says, 7-8, I must be hungry. 7-8, be not deceived. God is not mocked. For whatsoever a man soweth, what does it say? That shall he also reap. Don't stop there. It explains it a little bit further. It says, for he that soweth to his flesh, of the flesh shall reap what? Corruption. But he that soweth to the Spirit shall of the Spirit reap life everlasting. So if in your sowing and your attitude, if you are sowing corruption, that's what you're going to reap. It's going to be evident. Amen. You can't blame everything on everybody else that's around you. Sometimes it is your fault. Amen. Women, listen. You can't always blame everything on your husband. Sometimes it is your fault. Men, listen. I'm not going to leave men out. You can't blame everything on your wives. Sometimes it is your fault. Amen. Children, you can't blame everything on your parents. Usually it is your fault. But y'all get what I'm saying, right? Amen. You know, in this world we live in, it's easy to get lazy, ain't it? It's easy to get blind. It's easy to get sleepy. Let's go over the Proverbs real quick. Proverbs 24, 33-34, and Proverbs 6, 10-11 give us the same warning. And I want to read that to you. 24:33-34. Says, get a little sleep, a little slumber, a little folding of the hands to sleep. So shall thy poverty come as one that travaileth, and thy want as an armed man. You understand what he's saying? They'll sleep, but they're not paying attention to what's coming, and there's going to be destruction come up. It's going to come up underneath you. It's going to come before you know it because you were lazy and sleeping and not doing what you should have done. Yet a little sleep, a little slumber, a little folding of the hands to sleep, so shall thy poverty come as one that travail, and one thy want as an armed man. If you look above these verses, up to 30 through 31, you can get a picture of what a slothful man comes to his estate. Let's look up there just for a second. It says, I went by the field of the slothful, and by the vineyard of the man void of understanding. And lo, it was grown over with thorns and nettles, covered the face thereof, and the stone wall thereof had broken down. Then I saw and considered it well, and I looked upon it and received instruction, and the instruction of what I just read. If you don't give and take care of what you got, it's going to come to destruction, right? It's going to be yet over in thorns and briars. Kenneth knows the place I'm talking about because he came down there and helped me on some of the work. A friend, he'd become a friend, a guy that we worked for, he'd bought an excavator. And he'd used it one time or twice, and he set it down next to the woods. And that's brand new, set it down next to the woods. And I go there, I need it to dig a hole, or going to try to dig a hole, where we're at. And I go looking for it, he tells me where it is, and I cannot find it. It's only been there for like 3 months. 3 months. And I would go look and look and look, and then finally, I see just a little glimmer of orange. And what had happened, the vines and the thorns had overgrew it and completely consumed it into the woods, except for just that little bit. The ants had piled up in the back of it all through it, and it had a wasp nest as big as a hubcap that was in it. When I went out there to start it, I didn't find it till I finally got it started and moved out of the branches, the wasp nest and everything, because they started flying. But that's a definite picture of what we're seeing here. You just leave things sitting, it's going to grow up. Right now, he's trying different things to grow in his field to see what's going to grow the less. He's just letting it grow as tall as it wants to the seed. And what he planted, they done had one cork cutting, and it was already back up 6 foot tall for hay. 6 foot tall. And then that out there and the rest of it's probably 8 foot in parts, ain't it? Where you go in there. He's doing it on purpose. But a slothful person, yeah, that's a picture of how everything can be dissolved away. How the enemy will creep in little by little by little, and then he'll overtake it. The vines that the devil will put forth, the thorns that he'll put in your life. If you don't deal with them as they come up, then they will consume you and you will just become part of them. Right? Part of them. Think about it. Let's go over the Proverbs 19 real quick. 19:15. I think everybody should highlight this in their Bible just so they remember not to get slothful. Slothfulness casteth into a deep sleep, and an idle soul shall what?
Suffer hunger.
Shall suffer hunger. An idle what? Soul shall suffer hunger. If you get lazy and you give up and you just give in, your idle soul is going to suffer hunger. It's going to suffer thirst. It's going to suffer things like it's never done. Why? Because that idle soul is distancing itself from God. The more you give up, the more lazy you get, the more you give in, the more you stop the fight, the more you stop the work, the more you stop dealing with the things in your life that are creeping in, the more you're going to be defeated, the more you're going to be consumed, and the more you're going to suffer because of your choices to not do anything. Because of your choices to not do anything. Sometimes doing nothing is the wrong answer. Right?
Amen.
We're living in a world that says, oh, this don't do nothing. It'll be okay. Just let it be. Let them be. Kids acting up. Oh, just let them be. It don't matter. The Black Lives Matter rioting like they did 4 years ago and everything that was going on. Oh, just let them be. They're, what did they say? They're just voicing their anger and their frustration. Just let them be. Look what they did. The destruction that they caused. They actually hurt more black people than they did white people in what they were doing. The businesses that they burned. Just let them be. Right? Spiritually speaking, we've got a problem because people are letting it be too much in their own heart. Well, I feel this way. I feel this aggression. I feel this anger. I feel this hate. Just let it be. Don't deal with it. But the more that you let that seed grow in you, the more it will consume you, your thoughts. The more you let that seed of laziness grow in you, it will make you so tired. It will wear you out. The more you let that spirit of defeat grow in you, it will defeat you. The thing that we got to do to overcome it is to get active. To get proactive. To address the things as they come up. Amen. You want to see your families get right with God, you got to get proactive on it. You got to say things to them. You got to stand against sin and not condone sin.
Amen.
Right? You know, God has called us to do something. I've said this many times. God didn't call us to sit on our hands on the pews. You know, your work for God is not showing up to church.
Amen.
That's a privilege. That's a blessing. That we have assembled together, that we might get encouragement, that we might be able to pray together as a family. That's a privilege. That's not your work. Your work is what you go forth and do when you leave here. And by not working, you're getting lazy, and the devil's winning. By not fighting, you're getting defeated. You may think you're the biggest one there is. You may be proud and think ain't nobody can whoop me. Devil's got you wrapped around his finger. That's exactly what's happening.
Amen.
Right? But God has called us to be going forth to work. Let's turn over to Luke chapter 10. I was going to say Luke's writing, but I said Luke's. Luke chapter 10, verse 2. Jesus said these words. He said, therefore he said to them, the harvest truly is great, but the laborers are few. Pray ye therefore the Lord of the heavens that he would send forth laborers into the harvest. Are you praying that? Anybody praying that? I don't see a single hand going up. Saying that God, praying that God would send forth laborers into the harvest.
Amen.
Why ain't you praying that? Chase, you want me to know, want me to tell you why most people don't pray that? Because they're afraid God will choose them to go.
Amen.
But be honest now. The reason that most people ain't praying, Lord, please send laborers into the harvest, into the field to work, is because they're afraid God will say, okay, let's go. Do you not want to serve him? Do you not love him enough to serve him? You know, Ruckman, y'all know I like to listen to him sometimes. He said, is he not worth serving? Is he not done enough? Huh? Why ain't we praying? Why are we praying, God, use me? Here am I, Lord, use me. Huh? Because you don't want to be used. That's what it boils down to. Think about it. If you really want to be used, you would pray. Right? The problem is, too many times we labor for that which we can see. We labor for meat, we labor for clothing and food and everything else. We want our rewards in this life. Now come on, you want your rewards in this life. You're going to say, I ain't going to work for nothing. Come on. If you showed up every day to work and you didn't get no pay, how long are you going to keep on working there? Not very long, right? But God's going to pay you. Everybody's talking about the 401 plan and everything. God's got the best retirement plan that there is. He's going to pay you. He's going to take care of you. You know, in John 6 and 27, the Lord said, labor not for the meat which perisheth, but for the meat which endureth unto everlasting life, which the Son of Man shall give unto you, for him hath God the Father sealed. Think about that. Like, we're not, they wasn't telling you not to work. Paul said, if you work not, you eat not, right? But he's telling you, your desires and labor should be for the Father, for the kingdom to come. But we just cast it out. We need to understand something. We're not here in this life to satisfy our own lust and our own desires. You understand that? Now, come on. Do you understand that? That's not why we're here. That's not why we were saved. We're not here to satisfy our own lust and our own desires. That's what the devil wants you to think you were put here for. You understand? Let me ask you a question. What are you making more plans to do? Tomorrow? The next day? The day after? What are you making more plans to do? What is more important to you? What are you just got on your mind? Man, we're going to go do this. I'm going to go do that. This is going to be done. I'm going to have a good time. I'm just going to lay back. Where's God in the picture? How many of you are making plans? Well, I'm going to try to witness to so many people tomorrow. I'm going to do my best to try to witness to so many people. Lord, you just put them in my way. Lord, let me talk to them. Lord, I'm getting ready to go on a trip, but I want you to be with me, and I want to go as far as I can and give you praise everywhere I go. Lord, help me remember to get some tracts that maybe I can give somebody something. How much of that is going in your mind? You know, I brought out in Bible study this. A man once said, I was reading about it, and I may misquote it because I ain't got it wrote, but I'm going to do the best I can. He said, if there's anything more important to you, or if there's anything that brings you more happiness in your life than salvation, then you're in a backslid condition. Amen. If there's anything in your life that brings you more joy, more happiness than salvation, then you're in a backslid condition and you don't even realize it. That could be from your children to your grandchildren to your friends, having a good time. If something brings you more joy than Jesus Christ, then you're in a backsliding condition.
Amen.
And you're on the verge of falling out. You're on the verge of giving up. But we shouldn't be doing it. You know, we're put here to serve God and to please Him. You understand that? That's why we were created. We were created for God to be God's company and to serve Him. He, you know, He used to walk in the garden with Adam and Eve. Then when sin came, He couldn't walk in the garden with them no more. Amen. Right? Now, this brings us back to the verses that we started in. Let's go back over to Zechariah chapter 3. I want to read the first verse there. It says, and he showed me Joshua the high priest standing before the angel of the Lord, and Satan standing at his right hand to resist him. Now, in this verse, who was standing to resist the high priest? Satan. We understand this is a vision, and there's a lot that spiritually ties into this, and there's a lot of prophecy that ties into all this right here. But for the purpose of what we're talking about, I want you to understand the reality that Satan is standing ready to resist is real. You understand that? It says, the devil is constantly striving with us. Y'all believe that? If you're saved, the devil is constantly striving with us to try to get us to doubt God's word, to doubt God, to lose our faith, to lose our joy, to get us to give up, as I was talking about earlier, whether it be through the weariness of our heart, whether it be through depression, or whether it be through laziness, whatever. He is striving with us to resist us, to try to make us think that God don't care and that God's not going to help us. He is. Every day, He is doing it. You know, When you look at it, he wants us to just think that we're useless. How many of you are useless? I got one raising their hand back there. That's what the devil wants you to think, but you're not. You understand that? Every one of you's got a potential to do and be something for the glory of God. Amen? Y'all believe that?
Amen.
Think about it. You know, our number one enemy, other than ourselves, because you're a pretty big enemy to yourself, but our number one enemy besides ourselves is not the people around us. It's the devil that is using the people around us. He's slipping in and getting in on them, in their minds and their hearts, and he'll use them to come against you. He got in Judas, didn't he? Do you think that he can't get in somebody else?
Amen.
Somebody that you thought was a friend, somebody that you thought was a brother, somebody, the devil will get in and he'll use them. You know, Donna, everybody professes to be a Christian, ain't they? Amen?
Amen.
Amen. But he's standing there resisting us. And he's wanting to tear us apart. He wants to what? Wear us out. You can find reference to that in Daniel 7:26, where it talks about when it's comparing about the end times and everything, about wearing out the saints. You know, that's one of the goals of the devil. He wants to wear us out.
Amen.
Wear us out. That's why he does it. It's nothing new. You understand that? Your sorrow, your hardships, your pains, your sufferings, they are nothing new. What did Ecclesiastes say? There is nothing new under the sun, right?
Amen.
So when we get on our pity parties and we get down and we think nobody has ever suffered like that. I knew a person, and y'all would know them too if I said their name. But I'm not going to say their name. But they would come and they would say, oh, nobody's ever been tempted like me. Nobody's ever had a hard life like me. And most of the things in the person's life are things he was intentionally bringing upon himself. And that's what they always said, Nancy. Nobody. Nobody has seen what I... Nobody's hurt the way I've hurt. Nobody's been tempted. The devil ain't come against nobody like me. And I'd be like, really? Really? Come on now. There's always somebody in worse condition, right?
Amen.
Why would you want to give up the battle? Why would you want to lay down and let Satan take control when the war is almost over? You know how dumb it'd been in World War II if after the Nazis was beat, Japan and everything, and it was coming to the close of the war, if all the Allied forces just laid down and stopped taking control the way they was going to, what would have happened? Germany would have just fired it back up and started all over again, wouldn't it? Right? The devil, the great deceiver, has even begun to deceive himself, because somewhere in his heart, in his desire to be God, in his desire to be worshipped, he thinks that somewhere he's got a chance. But he don't have a chance. His chances are zero. You've been told, we brought it out many times about how we wrestle against principalities and wickedness in high places, right? Right? We've talked about it over and over and over. But let me show you something else this evening. Do you know how easily the devil can be shut up? Do you? You know how easily the devil can be shut up? Let's look over here to verse 2 in Zechariah, in chapter 3. He said, and the Lord said unto Satan, the Lord rebuke thee, O Satan, even the Lord that hath chosen Jerusalem rebuke thee. Is not this a brand plucked out of the fire? Does that response sound familiar to anybody? Huh? Let's turn over to Jude. Book of Jude. Last one before Revelation. Jude 1 and 9. Says, yet Michael the archangel, when contending with the devil, disputed about the body of Moses, does not bring against him a railing accusation, but he said what? The Lord rebuked thee. Who won that battle?
The Lord.
Michael. Right? Michael. We are not defenseless, as you might think that you are sometimes. You're not without help, though it may feel like it is sometimes. Though the burden is heavy, the Lord has told us what to do with it. What did he say? He said, come unto me, ye who labor and heavy laden, and I'll give you rest. You know what the problem is? You ain't laboring. You're just heavy laden. Right? Think about it. We are not in this battle alone. So, you know, don't let your sorrow or your self-pride or your sin swallow up your hope. Because your hope is more important than your pride or your sin. You need to come and get help and release from those things that are binding you, right? If you are laboring in this life, as I said, you're going to have trouble. You're going to have sorrow. You're going to have pain. But don't give up. What in 1 Corinthians? Let's turn over there. 1 Corinthians. We've talked about this. We've quoted it many times. We're just going to bring it out so you can see it. 1 Corinthians chapter 10. 1 Corinthians chapter 10. You've heard us quote it. There's signs that say it, but they never say it all the way. These new modern age preachers leave out part of the verse when they're saying it. 10 and 13. I think you ought to highlight that verse in your Bible as well. I would mark it to where you always know where it is, okay? And when you see these signs in the store and you see that they don't fulfill it all, say, that ain't what that verse says. And then remember what it says. It says, there hath no temptation taken you, but as such as is common to man. So your trials, where the devil's tempting you, warring against you, striving against you, it's nothing new, as I said a while ago. It's common among man. You're not the only one, okay? But God is faithful. What does that mean? What it says, right? God is faithful. That means he's going to be with you. That he's not forgotten you. That he's not forsaken you. It says, who will not? Who will not? God will not suffer you to be tempted above that you are able. Now, that's where people stop the verse. They just leave it there. There's more to the verse, though. Next it says, but with the temptation, also make a way to escape that you may be able to bear it. Didn't say that you wouldn't be able to be tempted. Didn't say that the temptation wouldn't get hard. It ain't saying that the devil ain't going to come against you with all he's got sometimes and try to make you bend and try to make you quake. But says that God is faithful and that he will not allow you to be tempted more than you can bear, but he will make with that temptation a way of escape. Not that you will be set free from all temptation, but that you may be what? Able to bear it. Did that say that every trial was going to take away? Everything the devil was throwing at you was going to be taken away? No, he said he's going to help you carry your load. Amen? He's going to help you carry your load. You know, I'm clinging to my hope and looking for that escape when the trials get fierce. But more than that, I'm looking for the blessed victory that is going to come when Jesus steps forward and wins the fight, wins the war, wins the battle, when the devil is put under into the lake of fire. Until then, we must not give up. Until the rapture, until God calls us home, we must not give up. We must keep on working. We must keep on laboring. No matter how hard the temptation gets.
Amen. Amen.
You know, when you don't feel like praying, that's the time to pray.
Amen.
When you don't feel like working, that's the time to work. I can testify to that. I know myself. There's times I wake up that my hands hurt so bad, my back and my knees and everything hurt so bad. If I sit at home, I'm just going to hurt worse.
Amen.
You know what eases the pain? Getting out there and working. You know, spiritually speaking, what will help ease your pain? Getting out there and working. Going out there and doing something for God. Doing something to lift Him up. Doing something for somebody else. Being a testimony. Being a witness. Don't give up the battle.
Amen.
The war is almost won. The war is almost won. How many of y'all still believe Jesus is coming back?
Amen.
How many of you still work looking for Him?
Amen.
Amen. How many of you is willing to serve Him? Didn't sound as loud
on
that one. Amen. How many of you are going to do what the Bible says and pray that God will send laborers? Huh? And how many of you will be obedient and if He asked to let Him send you?
Amen.
Endurance. Keeping on. Going for the glory of God. If we don't have soldiers that are tempered and able to carry on, that are established in their faith and strong, then we're going to lose. We're going to lose our loved ones to the devil. We're going to lose our cities to the devil. We're going to lose our country to the devil. And it's headed that way. Because people have gotten complacent and refused to work. All they want is the benefits of being a Christian. People think if you get saved, you can just go sin and do whatever. I don't work like that. Say, well, I'm washed in the blood. Well, only if you really were.
Amen.
You won't want to go just try to do all this sin if you really got saved. There's a difference there. I told y'all I believe that there's, and given the right circumstance, that a Christian commit any sin, but they're not going to continue in those sins.
Amen.
But God don't whoop the devil out of them. Maybe that's what needs to happen to you tonight. Maybe God needs to pick you up like a puppy by the nape of the neck and just spank your bottom because of what you're doing and the choices that you've made. Maybe you've messed somewhere you shouldn't mess. Spiritually speaking. In other words, maybe you put your 2 cents worth in somewhere you shouldn't have stuck it because you didn't know what you was talking about. Huh? Maybe you've been going staying at somebody else's house instead of God's house. Think about that, spiritually speaking. That's the message the Lord has for me this evening. Don't give up the fight. Because the war is almost over.
Amen.
I'm going to pray and then I'll give an invitation. And you know, we've said many times, people think that when you give an invitation that people's going to judge you because you come to this altar. They better not, and I hear about it.
Yep.
You need, if you're going to judge somebody, you need to be falling down on your knees before you get it all. You might as well fall down there on the floor before you make it up here.
Amen.
This is a place to find hope, help, and strength. It used to be a place, and I miss those days, to when one would pray, everybody would come to pray with
man.
I miss those days. What's wrong? Why can't we be that way again? If you see your brother have a need, why not help him bear it, right? Amen. Let us pray. Lord, we come before you as humble as we know how.
Thank you, Lord, for this day.
So thankful for this day and for the message that you sent. You know why you changed it from what it was going
to
be. Lord, we just ask that you would search the hearts and souls as only you can. Lord, I pray that every heart would find exactly what they need in you here this evening. Whatever it may be. Both those watching, both those gathered here, and those that will watch later. And in all things, God, we lift you high and we give you praise because you're worthy. And we love you, Jesus.
God bless the church.
Jesus' name.
Amen.
Touch
your hands, Lord, in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen.
Well, I asked everybody would stand. That gets you a little bit closer to maybe coming to the altar if you're going to. A little less is used not to.
I hear the Savior say, "My strength in me is small. Time of weakness, watch and pray. Find in me thy all in all. Jesus, take it all to be my own. Sin had left a crimson stain. He was
goodbye to the Facebook audience.
Your last one, go pray.
Huh? Oh, we'll pray. Let's pray with her, y'all.
Father, oh, Lord, as we come to you, God, we're thankful, Lord, for this opportunity.
So thankful, God.
Lord, just so bow down this opportunity, God, and just pray and seek that place.
You know what's on my heart.
Just believe tonight, pray God, that you'll wrap your arms around
upon your name.
And let her feel your presence.
Lord,
to
Lord, I pray that you will touch us on this. You
pour out your blessing, God.
Lord, we just want to give you all the praise,
Lord,
honor, and glory.
You be the author of
Lord, forgive us for where we have fallen. Forgive us, Lord, for where we have failed. Lord, give us strength to carry on for the goodness
of thy name.
God, we just ask
you to answer the prayer tonight. Dear God,
Lord,
to
the glory of thy name.
Thank you, God. We love you so much. We thank you so much for all that you've done and all you're going to do. In Jesus' name, thank you. Amen.
Altar's always open. Somebody feels like they need to pray.
Amen.
You know what I didn't ask? Somebody know what I didn't ask?
Yeah.
Are you okay with the Lord?
Can everybody here, in the right lines, can everybody here say
that's good.
That you know without a shadow of doubt that everything is good between you and the Lord this evening.
Amen.
I barely hear.
Amen.
Huh? My ears are stopped up. Say it like you was trying to wake God up. He ain't asleep, but say it like you was trying to wake him up.
Amen.
All right, all right. Well, we love y'all. The Facebook audience will say farewell till Sunday at 7 o'clock in the morning. We love y'all and appreciate you. Go ahead, Lights. You can cut it off. Go ahead. And everybody else, is there any announcements? I know.